I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Moving Beyond the Rhetoric.
And I'm Miss Brett. Welcome, everyone. It's all right. Let's put your hands together. Okay.
So tonight is a special night. It's a night where we bring together several media platforms and people that are interested in building community, in finding solutions to problems. Lord knows we have problems in our country, in our community, and the subject is serious. It's grave. It's important that we have this conversation. I'm pleased that we've assembled a number of media houses in town to collaborate, bringing this rich conversation to thousands and thousands on local television and radio. I want to acknowledge our partners, CTV, KFAI Broadcasting Live, KMOJ Broadcasting Live, KALY Somali FM Broadcasting Live. And I want to acknowledge not only SPNN, but the Minnesota Multicultural Media Consortium and my newspaper, Insight News.
Now, when we look back at this moment in history, people are going to be talking about what's happening in America right now, years from now. In the day and age of social media, we're getting inundated with messaging, many of it being traumatic, many of it being inaccurate, most of it not moving us towards solutions, but merely keeping our wheels spinning and making us feel like there's no solution. So the purpose of today is to remind people that we do have control over what happens in this nation. The power is and always has been with the people, and there most definitely are solutions. If you're watching at home, listening on the radio, or in the audience with us, there is a hashtag, Beyond the Rhetoric. If something that you hear on this panel or that you think of moves you, you can use that hashtag and get your questions answered. Even if you're not live in the studio with us, we have a wonderful floor director who's going to be passing us all of your feedback, your questions, your comments, and your concerns. So we thank you again for joining us.
So let us introduce our panelists first. And on my left, Bill Woodson is a PhD student and research fellow at University of Minnesota. He's the former assistant dean at University of St. Thomas. He's the founder of Learners to Leaders and creator of the Outreach Scholarship at the University of St. Thomas. He's here seeking to launch a community justice pipeline scholarship program at the University of Minnesota. And he's had some friends that have been meeting regularly talking about how we arrive at solutions. His friends are academics. They are serving police chiefs. They are serving officers and community people, trying to create a platform to make that happen. Next, Asha Long. She's an organizer for Black Lives Matter Minneapolis. Give them a hand. Black Lives Matter Minneapolis. She's a campus organizer at MPIRG, and she is a visual artist. And on my side of the panel, at the very end to my left, is Andre Cohen. He's a speaker, a teacher, and a racial justice advocate.
Excellent. Also joining us all the way at the end of the table on my right is Kathleen Cole, who's an assistant professor of political science at Metropolitan State University and is also a core team member of SURGE, which is Showing Up for Racial Justice in Minnesota. Next to Kathleen is Andrea Jenkins, who is a awesome poet, has an MFA in creative writing from Hamline, is currently the transgender oral historian for a project at the University of Minnesota, specializing in GLBT studies. Andrea's work has appeared in a number of publications across the globe, and Andrea actually was recently invited to the White House. That wasn't in her bio, but I had to show that love and give those props. So we might hear about that trip in a little bit. And also directly to my right is Dr. Bravada Garrett Akinsaya, who is a licensed clinical psychologist and fellow in African American mental health and Black psychology. Dr. B has over 30 years of experience as a Minnesota provider and is the president of Bracken's Consulting in Psychiatric Services and is the ex-director of AACI.
Mm-hmm. African American Child Wellness Institute.
There it is. Please welcome our panel.
So I want to begin by jumping right into the conversation. And I think we set a baseline by asking each of the panelists to say what's on their mind, what's in their heart, where their passion is around the topic. Ms. Britt, maybe set up a little bit more why we're here, because of the killings of mm-hmm. black men by police. And we have to be mindful of the killings of police officers as well.
Absolutely.
Talk about that for a second, and then we'll ask the panelists each to open up their statement.
So we're in a very unique moment, especially here in the Twin Cities. It seems like we are still dealing with the unjust killing of Jamar Clark. And unexpectedly, just a few weeks ago, we then lost Philando Castile at the hands of another police officer. Within that week, there was also Alton Sterling, who was killed down south. And there was also the killings of several police officers in Dallas. Now, 2 weeks since then, which is when we originally planned this program, there have been even more killings of Native Americans at the hands of police, as well as additional police officers killed. So we're in a moment of extreme and intense violence. We're in a moment of trauma. We haven't moved on from the original trauma that we've experienced, whether it's been Jim Crow, whether it's been mass incarceration. And now with the wake of social media, and especially as we saw in the case of Philando Sterling, social media gives us access to seeing things in real time. People who are watching at home and listening on the radio are witnessing this in real time. So we're taking our technology back and saying, we're not just gonna use technology to traumatize ourselves or using it when we feel like we need to hold our law enforcement accountable. We're going to use this moment with our media access, with our technology, to push forward and to find some solutions. Everyone here plays a different role in doing work to make sure that our community is safe and that they get what they need. And we're going to find solutions, not to create further division, because I think there definitely is one in this moment, but we're going to try and figure out how can we come together to find a solution. So if any one of our panelists want to jump in with what they do, and how they contribute to all of us as a community coming together or addressing any of this violence, please do so.
Let me start. Do you mind? I think I'd like to start talking about the psychological impact of what we're dealing with. Because there's a long legacy in America, of course, of slavery. And during that time, the only way that slave masters could enslave other human beings was to dehumanize us. So that process of dehumanization continues to this day. And the separation between people based on skin tone, skin color, white versus dark, is so insidious and so often experienced that these microaggressions that we feel impact us psychologically. And in fact, it carries through our DNA. Our studies on animals show that when they're exposed to trauma or traumatic events, even their offspring, without even being exposed to the trauma, continue to react to those same stimuli in a traumatic way. So in our society, we have angel's food cake is white, but devil's food cake is dark, right? Magic's all right unless it's black magic, right? Male's okay unless it's black male. And in our society, even a lie becomes all right if it's a white lie. So all of us are recovering from this insidious, unconscious projections of racism that impact our immediate judgment. And that immediate judgment is called implicit bias, because these biases are learned, and they're learned from the moment we are born, and they're learned in very subtle ways, and they lead to dissonance, because we can't harm another human being if they are part of us. We can't dislike or hurt them if we see them as our brothers and sisters. And this hurting process has led to oppressive reactive syndromes that have led us into being traumatized, not as just black people, but as white people, as Americans. We are traumatized, and we continue to inflict that trauma on one another. And I believe that's what the panel is going to articulate a little bit better than that.
And if I can just piggyback on what you said.
And say your name again first.
My name is Andre Cohen. And the part that's most insidious about what Dr. B just talked about is that we are dehumanized, or we're tricked out of understanding what our humanity is. There are 48 chromosomes that make up the human body. Racism does not decrease those chromosomes. I am born completely human, whether I'm blind, whether I have some kind of birth defect, but because I have those 48 chromosomes, I am human. There is nothing that can happen that decreases my humanity unless I am tricked into laying it down. And so when we talk about systems of oppression have been designed to trick us out of our birthright of our humanity. And so therefore, if I can teach young people that they are not kings and queens, that they're not doctors and lawyers, I can convince them that they're beasts.
Bill?
And yeah.
Bill Woodson.
So I resonate with everything that's been said so far. I approach this work from the other side. I've done work in diversity and inclusion, but I've come at it from a standpoint of organizational effectiveness. And from a business perspective, I've also been an academic administrator. And what we have to understand is that these systems are in place because they served a function, but the roots of that function and then how that function has evolved over time has led to some dysfunction that is now impacting their ability to fulfill their mission. So policing is something that is in some ways very ancient, but in other ways it's really only 100, 150 years old. And it actually grew out of out of London, and Sir Robert Peel, who had these Peelian principles, which described policing as a function where citizens empower certain members of that citizenry to provide stability and to enforce social expectations. But that comes in direct conflict to how policing emerged out of the United States in our tradition, where it really grew primarily out of a tradition of the paddy roller and the slave master delegating the authority to manage and repress primarily slaves, people of color, and that repressive function has morphed and evolved, but it lingers today. And these two principles are both enacting. They're both present, but we have to recognize that dysfunction has to be surfaced, and we have to come back to a point of keeping law enforcement accountable to bad behavior. We have this false dichotomy, this false binary today, where either you are in support of police and you think Black Lives Matter is illegitimate, or you support reducing of police violence, and therefore that means you're anti-police. And that's a false binary. There's no reason why we shouldn't be embracing both the safety of our law enforcement officers and the safety of our citizens. But we have to come back to understand what is the principles behind policing, and then why is it that we've created a culture in our law enforcement that prevents that primary mission of serving the community to be so badly damaged. And that damage shows up as well in the loss of community faith in policing. And frankly, policing can't function. And law enforcement officers will tell you, law enforcement leaders will tell you, that policing can't work if it's not seen as a legitimate force in the community. So we have a shared interest, and we have to recognize that shared interest.
Asha Long, bring up the young point of view, the youth point of view. You are one of the organizers of Black Lives Matter Minneapolis, and as often as not, we are told that there is a divide, a different analysis of how the world works and how problems can be solved, those presented by young people and those presented by those of us who are older, part of what we call the legacy leadership. But address that, if you would, and address the urgency of the work Black Lives Matter is doing right now in this city and around the country.
Well, I think it's important that we note that at this time we are definitely in a state of de facto black genocide. Black lives are being lost at an astronomical rate every day. Unarmed black people are being murdered by the police. And, you know, with Black Lives Matter, which this wave of our movement has been led by women, queer women. Black Lives Matter was created by three queer women out of New York. It's important that we notice how the system is using our pain against us, how we notice that the world is increasingly becoming desensitized to black pain as we see murdered people become hashtag and become sensationalized and sexualized. Black Lives Matter is here to validate and love all aspects of the black diaspora. It's really important that we see and uplift our most marginalized voices, which are queer women of color. But blackness comes in a lot of different intersections. We have black queer people. We have black immigrants. We have black weirdos. I mean, it's really, what we're here for is to uplift all black voices. Now, when it comes to dealing with the state-sanctioned violence against black bodies, we have continuously chosen direct action. And a lot of people ask, why we think that's important. A lot of people ask, why do you have to stop me from going to work? Why do you have to interrupt my life? And the problem is this desensitization has caused us to not care at all about what happens to Black lives. In the last few years, we've seen these cases go up in the media. They become super popular and, again, sexualized. And we see them nationally be... people be acquitted, no charges coming down. The criminal justice system is saying exactly how they feel about black and brown bodies in the United States. And for us, direct action is important because a lot of these people in power positions have forgotten who they got their power from. We have a lot of middlemen when it comes to our power, whether that be the ballot or someone else that we think we have enlisted to serve for us. But when we step up and we step out into the streets and we stop people on their daily commutes in whatever capacity that we decide, it's important that we remember people. I mean, black resistance is not new. There has been black resistance as long as there have been black bodies in this country. And it's, I mean, direct action is how we bring the heat directly to the source of the power. It's how we remember that we yielded them this power, that it's actually our power that they are borrowing, that we have granted to them. And it's important that they recognize that they don't have that power if we do not recognize and give it to them. So with Black Lives Matter, we're here to be loud and upfront and radical and really push for things to be done, you know, as immediately as possible. I mean, I do believe that we have to work within different systems. I do believe we need to be both inside and outside, but we need to see how important it is to create the tensions in our communities to get stuff done.
Often during these direct action protests, what you're not seeing is all the community that's coming together, the camaraderie that's happening. People who don't know each other are holding hands and singing with one another. People who normally are introverts and don't say anything at all are getting up in front of crowds of people and doing poems and songs and chants and speaking about injustices that they've witnessed or speaking about the privilege that they've experienced and how they now have a new perspective and why they chose to be out in the street risking their life, risking arrest, not at work or wherever else they could be, why they choose to get in the street and stand up for Black lives. Someone who has been, since I've known of her, always been on the forefront of standing up for Black lives, and especially within the GLBTQ community, is Andrea Jenkins. As Asha mentioned, BLM was started by three queer women in New York. So if Andrea, if you could speak to the power of the GLBTQ community and also to the lack of representation in media, because often what we see is a group of men with microphones on camera who seem to get the credit for doing the work. It is typically a black life, a black male life that we see taken, not always, because this does in fact affect women too, but regardless, it is the women who are doing the work, it is the queer folk who are doing the work out front, yet somehow they seem to get omitted from the story. So,
wow, thank you for those comments, and thank you everyone who has spoken. I absolutely agree with all the comments that have been made thus far, particularly Asha uplifting Black Lives Matters and really, I think, breaking down the feelings that a lot of activists all over the country have been having. And I see those protests absolutely as a means of bringing attention and awareness to issues. And as you noted, we've been doing that since we landed on this continent. I mean, some people didn't even step foot on the sandy shores because they dived into the ocean as a sign of resistance. And so resistance is a historical part of our struggle in this country. And, you know, I think about the trauma that I experienced as a black person living in America. But then, you know, every day on my feed on social media, you know, I'm hearing about another black trans person being murdered.
That's right.
In addition to Philandro Castile and Alton Sterling and Jamar Clark, you know, and all since February or March, whenever our esteemed Hennepin County attorney decided that, you know, there will be no charges filed against those cops. I've been doing a 61-second moment of silence, but it seems moot now because there have been so many other egregious actions that have happened since then, and it's painful. And so I see these rallies as these protests, these gatherings, as a place for people to go and heal. That's what's happening in those spaces. If you went over to the 4th Precinct in Minneapolis, you know, during that 18-day occupation, which, think about it, 18 days occupying a police station. I haven't heard of that any place in the country. And these people are putting their lives at risk, laying down on 94, these issues are very serious. This is not about hatred of anyone. People who wear blue uniforms, people with white skin. This is about love of Black people and saying we deserve to be a part of this too. And so my struggle has always been to try to, while I'm saying that message, I need to talk to my Black brothers and sisters and say, LGB and particularly T people matter too.
Come on now.
Because, you know, if you, as you noted, Asha, women of color, Black women, are the absolute most oppressed people in this country, and you might say on the planet, right? But if you factor in being transgender and Black or Latino or Asian, your value to the broader society is even less. And we have 48 chromosomes too, Andre. And there's no taking away of my humanity. Like, that's not going to happen. And I think that's what Black people are saying. You know, I was saying to someone the other day that I think our role as a people on this planet, as Black people on this planet, when I use Black, I'm talking about the entire Black diaspora, is to bring love to this world. And it's a very, very difficult task, but we got to stay on it. We got to stay on the job.
Kathleen, can you speak to your role in the movement, particularly as a white ally, how all of this violence has impacted you and called you into action?
I'm not sure how well I'll be able to speak to that because my heart is still swelling from listening to Asha and Andrea. So I'm going to try to make some comments, but I don't know how well they'll go. I'm involved with a group called Showing Up for Racial Justice Minnesota, and we're a group of white people who our mission is to combat white supremacy, and we do that through educating, organizing, and mobilizing white people to take part in the movement for racial justice. And one of the things that's really central to the work that we see as ours is that we need to move to a place where white people who are involved in the movement for racial justice do not see this as about helping, but rather see that all of our liberation is tied up together. And so we are not coming in to help. We are not coming in as saviors. We are coming in because our very humanity and dignity depends upon doing the work. And so what we try to do at Surge is to meet white people where they are and find ways to have conversations with them, to train them to have conversations with other people around them, because one of the things that's really encouraged me in the last 2 weeks as we've been going through the tragedy of Philando's murder is the number of white people who have reached out and said, I know this is wrong, and I want to be able to do something about it. I want to be able to talk, and I just don't know how. I just don't know how I'm supposed to have this conversation. And so a lot of what we see as our project is educating white people to understand what white supremacy is, how we benefit from it, how we can use our position to undo it, to organize white people, because we've been told by people of color leaders for generations now that your job is to educate and organize your people, that that is not the job of black people, that that is the job of white people. And so we are trying to take on that work and have a space where we can bring white people in where they are, educate them, get them organized, and mobilize them. And part of that is mobilizing them within our own actions, but also we see that our work is about being accountable to people of color-led organizations. And a lot of that is about practicing followership. I think white people are often in the position of thinking that they have the relevant knowledge to understand what's at stake in a decision. So I can't tell you how many white people have said to me, I don't understand why they're shutting down freeways and they should be doing this, as though they have some knowledge of what people should be doing, you know, because white people are so accustomed to thinking whatever my knowledge is the relevant knowledge here for decision making. And so we're really trying to work on encouraging relationships of accountability with people of color who are in leadership roles in this movement, and also teaching people how to practice followership. How do you come into relationships with people of color who are in leadership positions and support their leadership in a way that is not about centering your own voice, but is really about saying, I need to take a step back, I need to listen, and I need to be in a position where you tell me what you need and what the best thing is, and I need to trust that your knowledge is the relevant knowledge here. And that's our project at Surge.
Bill Woodson, you're talking with professionals and police officers, chiefs, and academics. So how does this conversation relate to the conversations you're having? People who've got a history of public service, of public responsibility and accountability. In the post show, we're going to introduce you to Chief Greg Hestness, University of Minnesota law enforcement organization, and author Mike Quinn. But they're part of your team, and these are sort of storied leaders in the community. How does this conversation play out at your level?
Well, I think to answer that, I need to talk a bit about why I'm even in this conversation, because my background is not law enforcement and my background is not community activism. As I said, I'm coming from more of a corporate perspective, more of an organizational effectiveness perspective. And yet, as I moved into doctoral studies 2 years ago, I was just struck by the dynamics of what I'm seeing on TV in the summer of 2014 and Michael Brown and Eric Garner and the rest, and thinking I have to use this opportunity to be developed as a researcher to research how can we move this forward, and how and it felt like a situation, as I think I mentioned, where there's really no winner in a situation where an unarmed person dies at the hands of law enforcement. So why can't we fix this problem? And it seemed to me that it resonated around some type of an organizational effectiveness challenge, a leadership challenge, because leaders are telling me that they don't see they're fulfilling their function, law enforcement leaders, but yet this is happening on their watch and they're not happy with it either, and neither is the community. And so I reached out to people like Chief Hestness and like Mike Quinn to help me understand, well, how does law enforcement work? How is it designed to work? Because I figured I couldn't come in and say, let's make it better, unless I understood how it was designed to operate in the first place. And we started to discover some things. They started to teach me some things. I had also spoke with community leaders as well. I spoke to a lot of young black men. I had no idea at the beginning of my voyage 2 years ago that if you were to take the average 23-year-old African-American male living inside a city limits in Minneapolis or St. Paul, he's probably had a dozen, maybe two dozen contacts with law enforcement in the last 6 months to a year. I had no idea. And frankly, I think a lot of law enforcement officers who are out there stopping young black men and frisking them or asking them where they're going or asking for ID, they have no idea either. I found that law enforcement officers are very attuned to their vulnerability going into neighborhoods that are maybe foreign to them, except when they're at work. And maybe it's a dark alley. Maybe there was a murder around the corner from that alley. Maybe they don't. Maybe there was an APB for an African-American male of undefined description. And they know why they're afraid. But they have no idea, many of them, why it is that the young black man is walking in his neighborhood unarmed, not intending anything in particular, why when they come into the presence of a law enforcement officer, why that young man is afraid, often terrified. It might be because he has a friend who was roughed up by a cop in a recent time. It might have been that this is the fourth time in 2 months that he's been stopped by law enforcement and asked for ID. It might be that he's been handcuffed or thrown in the back of a police car. Oh, it wasn't you. Go on your way. But it's a traumatic event. And so I start to understand that there's this lack of compassion, a lack of appreciation for each the other's position. And so I was drawn to looking at solutions to that. And part of it, I think, is changing the identity of law enforcement, changing the identity such that communities of color are not being policed by suburbanites who only come into those communities when they're coming to work, and otherwise they don't have any connection with those communities. And I think part of it, too.
What do you mean by that? You mean hiring people from the neighborhood to do the police work?
You need to have people from the neighborhood, people who know that neighborhood. Absolutely. And there's some excellent police officers. These police officers here, they're former police officers, and they came from the communities. They policed their communities for years before they moved into their levels of responsibility. That doesn't happen so much anymore. You actually hear about law enforcement officers and some leaders who don't get it, like these gentlemen get it, that they don't think it's a good idea for law enforcement officers to be coming from the communities that they're policing, because then they might see people that they're arresting off duty, and you know, maybe they'll be held accountable for whatever treatment they gave to those people when they're arresting them. Well, if you can't be accountable to what you did to that person when you were at work, why should you feel like that's something that should be protected by being able to retreat to a suburban location until you come back to work the next day? That's not right. So we started to develop some solutions that, frankly, it's been a beautiful thing, just as you've heard these voices here, and no one is seeing an antagonism in terms of the vision is shared. We want everyone to be safe. Every law enforcement officer goes to work, they should all go home in one piece. Every person who walks out into their community, they should all go home in one piece without fear of law enforcement. And we all have that shared ideal. And I think that we have developed a pretty specific roadmap for how do we achieve that. And it has to do with how police officers are trained, how they're recruited, and how their performance is measured. And then we need to have a very focused effort in rebuilding relationships between law enforcement and communities of color. Young men and women shouldn't have their first encounter with a cop be asking for ID and why are you walking around here? It should, you know, why don't we have relationships with these officers? Why don't we have them coming into our schools and our communities? There's some great activities happening around the country where, you know, there's an intention to build relationship. If we're worried, I have a 36-year-old son. He's special needs. He's as peaceful and quiet as a lamb, but he's also 6 foot tall and 230 pounds. And he has the verbal skills of the average 12-year-old, 13-year-old. And I'm terrified for him when he goes into the face of law enforcement, what's going to happen. Because he might, one of the things he does when he's challenged or threatened, he doesn't talk very quickly. It takes him a while to process. And what does an officer think if he asks a young person, what is your name? And he doesn't get an answer. Wouldn't it be great if his first encounter with a law enforcement officer is in a community setting as opposed to, you know, when he's walking home from work at 5 o'clock at night?
Appropriate for me to get in, but I really wanted to comment on what you're saying, because my question as a psychologist is, how do you unlearn fear? They did a study in Stanford and UCLA Berkeley, and they asked Americans how they perceived African Americans. And the majority of Americans, according to this study, perceived African Americans as similar to apes. So if you see people who are animals, who are crazed, who are violent, who are dangerous, and you get conditioned. I don't know how many of you took Psychology 101, but the first lesson we learn is about Pavlov's dog, right? And it's parrot association. So when you see somebody and you've been conditioned your whole life that that person is dangerous, how do you unlearn fear? And then
just go to further talk about systems. Now children are learning fear in school of police officers because they call them safety officers, but they'll take a fourth grader in handcuffs out of the school. Fourth grader, 9 years old. So if we're having that kind of exchange as a pipeline for jail from the school setting, when we're saying hit the floors, get the walls, and we're taking kids out, why would they feel safe with a police officer? Secondly, I hate to break it down to you, but it's not even always color, it's the culture of policing. So we see a brother who's an African-American man who's a police officer, you can't know if you can trust him. Is he one of them or one of us? So let's just keep it real. We said we're going beyond rhetoric. Mm-hmm. Let's keep it real and talk about how do you unlearn fear? How do you unlearn abused power? How do you do that? Because that's what we all need to learn.
So if we're going to keep it real, then this is the elephant that's in the room, right? The answer to this particular question will set the tone for everything that we do and everything that we think. And this question simply is there something genetically wrong with black people that they show up on every negative indicator that there is? Health outcomes, economic development, reading scores, every health outcome, they come out negative. Is there something genetically wrong? If the answer is yes, then we need to get a vaccine for being black. If the answer is no, then we have to look at the systems that are creating the measurements by which we look at these outcomes. And so that is the question. And unfortunately, it is my belief that for some people, the answer is yes, there is something wrong with black people, which is why we have to have these programs, which is why we have to police them the way we do, which is why we have to interact with them in such a negative and condescending way, as opposed to looking at folks as being full of things as opposed to looking at them as having and suffering from deficits. I think that's one of the problems. The other thing is we also have to recognize that there are good police officers who break their backs every day to do the right thing. We talked a little bit about this pipeline. There's a group of officers right now from the 7-county metro area that formed a scholarship program called Law Enforcement Opportunities, LEO. Their website is laweo.org. And former Chief Tomas Smith comes out of there. Chief of Police in St. Cloud, Blair Anderson, comes out of that policing. And so when we have to encourage police officers to stand up, the good police officers to stand up and check their brothers and sisters just like they would check one of us. And so when we answer that question, is there something wrong with black people? We get our answer and we see what the answer is by the impacts in our communities. Black people make up 13% of the population. African American men are 8% of that population. How is it that disproportionately they show up in every negative indicators by 40 to almost 50% in every negative indicator? It points directly to systemic oppression and suppression by people who want to benefit from that system.
Yeah, and you know, I guess I would add to that.
Say your name again each time.
This is Andrea
Radio
Jenkins.
People.
Yeah, thank you. This is Andrea. I would only add to that, Andre, that you know. Many people, but most, I think, recently and most articulately that I've come across talking about this issue in a long time is Ta-Nehisi Coates, and he has written an article for The Atlantic called The Case for Reparations, and it really identifies, you know, this entire conversation that we're having and why the issues that are plaguing our communities exist. And then you pick up the book from Michelle Alexander, The New Jim Crow, and you begin to understand why policing in the United States shifted when it you know, was transported from London, and it became about protecting the commodity that was then black life, and some would argue still black life is commoditized in this culture. But protecting the wealth of the owners of that property, and that's still the same function at its core of police today, is to maintain the structures and institutions that, you know, rule and govern our societies. And those institutions are built by and upheld by wealthy individuals. And, you know, I mean, we look at the Republican convention right now and the amount of police force that is in place there. And yes, we are living in a time, I don't think I've ever thought that there would be a civil war in the United States, but a couple of days ago last week, man, I was like, wow, this shit is crazy.
It is.
And, you know, so there is a underlying issue, which is the systemic issues that are in place in all of our institutions mm-hmm. that have to shift. And it's not just the police department. I mean, who teaches our kids? Young white women from the suburbs. Yeah. They have the same level of awareness and empathy for those communities as do the police. And I'm sure they are very well-intentioned and very, very wonderful people. However, they do not have those connections to be able to teach and bring those children along in places, in ways that they can be successful in our culture and society. And that is done for a reason. You know, I took economics in college, 101. And, you know, in our culture and society, you have to have a 5% unemployment rate to have a really robust economy. Like, that's the number that really boosts your economy. If it goes lower than that, you're paying too much. If it gets much higher than that, you're not productive enough, right? And so who are those 5% of people?
Mm-hmm. Come on now.
It's black people. Jesus. And because we have 48 chromosomes, we gotta eat. And if I can't have a job, guess what? I'm going to still eat or die trying. And so, consequently, I got to sell cigarettes on the street. I got to sell CDs in front of the supermarket at 12 o'clock in the morning because I got to feed these kids.
And don't have a felony. Right?
Yeah. Which is impossible for that 23-year-old black man that has had 23 interactions with the police. Yeah. He's got a felony.
Yeah, it's crazy. I want to cover Dr. Bavada's observations in another way, too. And it's, I'm not saying anything that she doesn't already know, but just to connect it to the topic at hand. It's an intersection of some language that stumbles us and also some human nature. And I'm talking about how, from a language standpoint, we tend to conflate racism, which nobody's racist, right? And bias. And guess what? Everybody is biased. We have two flavors. We have the unconscious bias is what bites us and what kills us in society because hurts when you're not aware of those biases and then you act on them. And so the reason why you have hundreds and thousands of encounters where, you know, white folk, sometimes armed white folks, sometimes shooting guns at cops, and they somehow are still taken into custody safely. And yet we have hundreds, you know, 100, I think it was 105 black folks, almost all men, unarmed, and somehow their life has to be ended in order for the officer to feel safe. It has to do with a failure to recognize their unconscious bias. And so to the extent that we can help train our law enforcement officers more effectively, because we have trusted them with an amazing power. They have the power to stop and detain, and as we see, oftentimes kill without any repercussions, anyone on the planet pretty much. And if we're gonna give them that power, we have to make sure they are fully prepared and fully recognizing their human frailty and limitations, so that power is used in a way that allows them to serve their mission. And clearly, when we see these dramatic disparities in the fatalities of people of certain identities versus people of other identities, then we've got to do something to help them be in better touch with themselves. And by the way, of the 986 people that were killed by law enforcement in 2015, 45% of them were white. So I'm sorry, white folks, whether they know it or not, have a stake in improving law enforcement safety as well. So we should all, again, we're all on the same page. We should be. We all have the same desired outcome, and we just have to pull together to work on these things together.
Thank you.
All of those people who you named who had mental illness issues.
It's a very significant percentage.
So our society has created this sort of culture where we have put mental health in the hands of our police officers.
That's right.
And, you know,
law enforcement and then the criminal justice system and the penitentiary system. And it's not the right place to be handling those issues. We have to take that back.
In Chicago at Cook County Hospital, they just hired, which is the largest municipal jail in the country, they hired a mental health psychiatrist to run the jail because so many of those people have mental health issues.
Kathleen, you were going to say something. You were reaching for the mic.
I just really wanted to hold up what part of what Andrea was saying because I felt like it connected really nicely with what was said before, which was this conflict in the way that we think about cops as individuals and policing as an institution. I think in the United States, we've used police and prisons as a way of dealing with the people that neoliberal capitalism has discarded. And I'm saying that following Angela Davis, that's not my own idea. But I think Angela Davis is right about this, you know? And I think so much of the time we are so afraid, especially right now, given the climate where police officers have been murdered, to name that policing as an institution is a violent institution that deals with people that have been dehumanized. Because we're unable to separate policing as an institution from the people who are actually carrying out those jobs. And so I think it's important that we're thinking about the piece that you were bringing up. And I just wanted to hold that up for a second because I thought it was so important.
No, thank you. I know Chief Greg Hessness, and I probably met him, I don't know, 12 years ago, and he was on the board of the Minneapolis Urban League. And that's how you get to understand the community, you know, being engaged. So it's nothing against, I know many police chiefs, many police officers all around the country. Police are humans too. They have 48 chromosomes and they do courageous work. They don't get paid enough for the work that they do, which sets up some kind of feelings, as the young people would say. You know, and I think it's a shame that in our culture and society, you know, we value the stars of, I don't know, Ghostbusters 2 or whatever, more than we value the people who we ask to do the most dangerous jobs in our culture and society.
Mm-hmm. Audience, can we give a round of applause for our panelists? Thank you. Really quick, I know there were some folks in the audience who were writing down questions. For those of you who are watching at home or who are listening on the radio, I want to remind you that the hashtag is Beyond the Rhetoric. How many questions can we do before we're out of time? Two questions, all right. Can someone put their hand up and our floor director will come around? So we have one person coming to the mic right now. Can you state your name and your question? You can pick it up.
This is a good discussion. My name is Muhammad Khali. I live in this country 22 years. I'm executive director for Somali American Radio.
We happy to hear this good, this kind of good discussion. And the question I have here is, we live 22 years, we immigrant, we suffering a lot of different issues, you know? And I don't talk about the, I don't want to talk about the problem, but what I need to know is, what is the solution? That's the question we, everybody should be answering, because as you guys know, we come refugee 22 years ago in this country. When something happened somewhere in the United States, we're paying the price in Minnesota. So those are the questions we ask every day, where is the solution, and how can we all discussion about as a state level to talk about it, Islamophobia, and who we look like, how do we, in all those issues. Those are important for us, and we listen to the answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Panelist.
So first of all, I'd like to say that I think, obviously, training of...
Andre Keaton.
Yes, I'm sorry. My name is Andre Cohen. Cool. And I'd like to say that I think training of police officers is extremely important, but a specific kind of training. We've gone through sensitivity training. We've gone through cultural competence training. But I don't know that we've gotten to a place where we have relationship training. How do you build community? How do you use community policing as opposed to window-breaking policing? And so some of those policing philosophies need to be actualized in the building of relationships within communities. I also believe that transparency of the police in their relationships and responsibilities to the communities that they're in will also help change the nature of policing. The last part that I think we need to also recognize is that we have to change how we pay the pay structure of officers. Tenure, I believe, is problematic because you can last a long time but not be effective. You can hang around long enough to reach a threshold that you can't be fired because of union contracts and still not be effective. And so we have to also look at how do we reward and unionize our police officers.
I'd like to hear from Asha, because I really am concerned about and interested in the view of young people, Asha. And to a degree, the conversation we're having suggests that things are kind of okay and can be tweaked and fixed. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that's the case. Mm-hmm. I don't think you feel that. I don't feel that, but I want to hear you say it.
I don't feel that either. I definitely don't think that's the case. Well, one, as it comes to when we're talking about immigrants, I think it's really important that our Black communities unite under one Blackness, and we recognize that. I think that, you know, in my understanding, when it comes to Blackness and the issues we have with, Black people from the United States and immigrant communities, to me, I think the disconnect comes mostly from our trauma not looking the same, and our bodies don't carry trauma the same way, but we're still very traumatized people, and I think it's important that, again, we unite under our Blackness. But right now, looking at the system, once we do unite completely under our Blackness and go into the system, it's nothing that can be fixed, absolutely. It's something that has to be completely dismantled from the bottom and built from the ground up. It's important that we, you know, I mean, the system has never worked. It has always been broken. So why do we expect that we can make some patches to the foundation and it's going to be okay? We need to build a completely new house. I don't know. Is there anything?
Thank you. I know there are several hands up in the audience. We are down to 5 minutes for our live portion, and then we're going to have a whole nother hour with you who are in our studio audience. So we want to continue wrapping up with our panelists the solution. So panelists, if you can give us your offering for those listening at home who are no longer going to be with us for the second hour, what is the solution?
This is Andrea, and you know, I would just say a major part of that solution is the work that Kathleen and her friends are doing, and that's white people acknowledging and recognizing and beginning to dismantle white supremacy within that culture, because it is about humanity, and it's about all of us. And you know, I know if I'm being deeply impacted, even if people aren't recognizing it, they are being deeply impacted by these issues as well, financially, emotionally, physically, and all of those ways. So I think a big part of the solution is white people working to understand and dismantle white supremacy.
Can I jump in? Because I'd like to say, just like psychology gave us the idea of implicit bias and the connection of how we learn, we also have skills in unlearning. And so there are actual strategies of breaking down inappropriate learning, to break that response set that one has. And there are ways and strategies that we haven't actually brought to our communities. The science that we have can help us do that.
Mm-hmm. And where would you recommend for people who are looking to, on a psychological level, improve their cognitive dissonance, improve their own trauma, where would you recommend that they go?
I'd say the first thing you should do is go on the internet. There's a program called Project Implicit that is free, where you can look at your own biases in all areas, whether it be size, race, color, religion, anything, and you can see where it is, and you can make a program for yourself to deliberately take several steps, including immersion, exposure, reading, studying, learning about the culture, and engaging yourself introspectively. One more minute. So you can do that in order to see if you improve. And you can keep checking your scores. As they go down, you know you're getting better. And that's a real concrete way of deliberately changing that association.
And to find that website, you can Google search on Harvard Implicit Bias. Those three words will pop you right to that website. And it's fascinating. Okay.
There it is. We want to thank all of our panelists, Dr. Bravada, Garrett Akinsaya, Bill Woodson, Andrea Jenkins, Andre Cohen, Asha Long, and Kathleen Cole. We want to thank you guys so much, as well as my co-host, Al McFarlane. Thank you to SPNN and all of our sponsors. To all of you here in the audience, we're going to continue this conversation for another hour. For those of you watching at home or listening on the radio, what you can do is go on Facebook. There is a live stream happening if you want to continue to be a part of the situation and the solution and go beyond the rhetoric. You can do so, but most importantly, change starts within the home. So make sure you do your work, check your biases, and we thank you for viewing.